Thank you, choir. Well, it's good to be back with you today. It truly is. These fine gentlemen have a Bible that they'd love to put in your hands. If you don't have your own Bible this morning, please feel free to avail yourself of one that they have. It is good to be here. Many of you have heard about the boating accident that we had, and I was unable to be with you last week because they told me that I wasn't supposed to read, watch TV, read computers and all of that because of the concussion. And so I was being a good boy, staying home. And my wife was really diligent about that for some reason. So I am reminded of many things in Scripture. In Matthew chapter 6 and verse 34, it says this. It says, "So don't worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will take care of itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own." So many times the things that we worry about never come to pass, but we worry like crazy about them. And it's the things that we can't see coming down the track that so oftentimes impact us in difficult ways. Let's look to the Lord in prayer, shall we, this morning? Father God, we come to you today, mindful, Lord, of your great wisdom and how your great wisdom truly speaks into our hearts and minds as you put together the pieces of our lives. Father, it's our desire to be able to glorify you. And we pray, Lord, that the time that we spend now together would do just that. That you'd be lifted up, that you'd be magnified, and we would rejoice over how great you are. I pray this all now in Christ's precious name. Amen. Well, Karen and I want to thank you all for your concern over these last couple of weeks that we've had. You've been so nice and wonderful. Some have come by with food, and I've made you eat with me, and cards and phone calls, and I apologize for phone calls I wasn't able to get back to people on. And it's just really been an outpouring of love, and we really appreciate it tremendously. And we're excited about what the Lord has certainly for us. You know, something that always stands out when you have situations that kind of come out of the blue at you is, what is the spiritual lesson that we're to learn? You know, what is exactly our takeaway from it? Let me give you a little bit of background, because I've heard some rumors, and I like the one about we were pitched out of the boat and I sank unconscious for 10 fathoms. I came to when a tiger shark rubbed up against me. And yes, I finally had to whip out my knife and take his life. And then I buddy breathed off of his lungs until I got to the surface. Pastor Steve says, "Oh, you ought to tell the people exactly really what happened so that the rumors don't get crazy." Well, two Sundays ago, we were in Florida. We were at a pastor's conference, one that we've gone to many years, and we always hear great preaching there. I wish I remembered more from it, to be honest with you. And it was after that conference that we went down to Fort Myers. I have my two best friends in the world that are down there, and both that I've known since childhood. We went out to dinner with the one couple and had just a nice time with them. And then we went over and we stayed with my other friends. On Tuesday, it was my wife's birthday. And so I thought, this would be great. We're going to go out in the boat, and she loves to go out to the beach. And so we took an hour's drive to get to a special beach that has shark's teeth, and we started to look for shark's teeth. It was a great time. We loaded up on that beautiful sunny day. My friend has a 25-foot Mako boat, and he had his daughter, young 20s, and her 16-month-old baby boy along, and their little dog that has short legs, which is perfect for a boat. And we loaded up and we took off to the beach. It was a great time. We decided that we'd go in for some ice cream after we'd picked through the shark's teeth, and that's what we did. We came up through the intercoastal waterway. If you've ever been on the intercoastal before, it was flat, calm, and it was beautiful. We were in the area of Fort Myers, Cape Coral. Actually, if you know the area very well, we went underneath the bridge on the intercoastal that leads out to Gasparilla. So you have Boca Pass, where they catch all those tarpons and et cetera, and we were heading for Pine Island, where we'd put the boat in. He doesn't live far from there. We came out of the marina and we were going south on the intercoastal, and there are places there where you have to putter along and then you can come up to speed. So we came up to speed, wanted to get back, and it was windy, it was blowing, and I said to my wife, why don't you come up here? And she sat next to my best friend Roger at the helm, and I went back and sat on the cooler. Karen said, well, it was nice sitting there for a while, but she decided to come back and sit with me. And she sat with me, and honestly, that's the last thing I remember. She tells the story, I guess my buddy Roger's wife screamed when she realized they were going to hit a channel marker. They have channel markers that mark the intercoastal. They're the green and red markers, and they're usually about 20 feet in the air. I like them when they're made out of wood. This was made out of a steel I-beam, 14 inches, driven down into the stone. It wasn't going anywhere. My buddy's wife screamed, and he turned the wheel a little bit, so it wasn't dead on, just right on. It missed dead center by 6 inches. No one was pitched out of the boat, including the dog with short legs. I think he just got up there and put his jaws on that bow rail and held on for dear life. I don't remember a thing. Karen remembers seeing that just before we hit. So she's a little bit wigged out about traveling in boats, which I understand. After the impact was felt, the baby woke up, and we'd been teaching him how to clap all morning. He clapped. He thought it was great. The dog thought it was great. My buddy's wife didn't think it was great. She's broken her ankle in 3 places. You can pray for her. Her name's Karen. She goes to see the doctor finally this Tuesday. I don't remember anything. Karen said I laid on the deck and just bleeding profusely. I hate to do that, you know. It's just kind of... But the head wounds tend to bleed profusely. So yeah, and I was asking for help, and my wife says, well, you weren't totally unconscious. I don't remember anything. I don't remember at all. The first memory that I have was being strapped into an ambulance. So after the impact, it about ripped the boat in half. They called 911. So my buddy's daughter called 911, and they triangulate your position even out on the water. So it was really cool. They had fire and rescue there in less than 10 minutes' time, and fish and wildlife. I still don't know why they came. They don't want to miss out, you know. This is a big deal. They even put it in the paper down there, so it was a big deal. My dear Karen thought that my life might be over, and so did Roger. And they were calling for possible air flight to a trauma center. And when they got there, they realized that it would be faster if they could take the boat directly in, because it wasn't very far from a marina where they could put an ambulance. And so that's what they did. And my poor friend, who was all jittery, he had to drive because the rescue boats didn't have a place that was big enough for me to lay down. And so he drove under that duress and got in there to the marina, and there were 2 ambulances waiting. One took me to this trauma center, and the other 2 women went in the other ambulance to a different hospital. I'm starting to familiarize myself with them because I'm getting bills in the mail. We get there to those hospitals, and the first they ask you all these questions, and the first memory that I have is they're strapping me into this thing in this ambulance. I don't even remember the ambulance ride because I went back out, and then I woke up in the ER. And when I'm in the ER, they start asking you questions. They have you ever been asked those? The questions are hard questions. It's like, are you serious right now? I mean, it's like, what year is it? Where were you just now? Where are you now? I didn't know any of it. What month is it? I was like, oh. It's like, ask me an easy question. What state are you in? I had no idea. It's led to CAT scans and x-rays and all kinds of fun things like that. They kept asking me these questions. I remember getting, this lady came over with this needle and just jammed it in my arm for no apparently good reason. I said, what was that for? She said, that's a tetanus shot. I said, oh, I said, I just had a tetanus shot. I said, you should have just asked me. She said, she's like, you don't know what day it is, month it is, year it is. All right, point taken, point taken. I started to come to a little bit, and the first question I asked was, you know, how's Karen? How's my wife? How's everybody else? And they said, well, you're the worst one hurt. And I thought, oh, good, praise God. Because I knew at that point I wasn't going to die. Even though they might have thought something different, I knew it was fine. My son called me while I was there in the ER, and my buddy Roger had my cell phone, and so he handed me the phone. He said, here, it's David. And I talked to Dave. Dad, how are you? Because he wanted to come roaring right down the highway. I said, Dave, I'm fine. I'm good. Don't worry about me. Brain injuries are strange. I've learned that. I broke a bone in my face. I wasn't able to open my mouth more than just to take a straw in. I couldn't turn my head. My neck hurt so bad. But they x-rayed my neck. They said, you didn't break your neck. I was like, good. My mother always said I was going to break my neck, but see, I still haven't done that. And the CAT scan came back, and that was okay. And the next thing you know, they send you right out, like it's over. It's like, well, okay, here, sign this, and you can leave. And I'm like, what? And it's like, you got all this blood matted down in your hair. You'll need to wash that out good when you get home. It's like, okay. And those staples in your head, they put in like 9 staples. The doctor came in, and how he knows this is beyond me. He walks in. There's no, I'm not making this up. Now, I'm delirious, and I really have not mentally come to until this past Thursday. So you'll forgive me if I've said anything to you, emailed you, anything. I have no comprehension whatsoever. But he walks in. He says, hey, Pastor, let me take a look at you. And I'm thinking, glory, Lord. I mean, what does this guy want? He keeps calling me pastor. I'm thinking, you know, does he want me to pray for him? I mean, what could it possibly be? And he looks over my head, so well, you got a bunch of rat road rage here, blah, 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 road rash, rats, that's what it is. And he says, and he goes back and he finds this gash, and he says, oh my, he says, we're going to need the staple gun. I didn't know they stapled people's heads, but it was helpful because it kept everything in. And that was good. So he went to town on this, just, you know, putting those staples in there. And that was great. The needle numbing it really didn't work. And then they told me, you can go home. And they said, you know, you've had a bad concussion, and you need to wake up every 2 hours. And so that's what's neat about those alarms on your phone. So I just set my phone every 2 hours. The second time it went, I just took the phone, turned it off, and threw it across the room. Didn't want to be bothered with that. The next day we flew home. I've been told by so many people that you shouldn't fly when you've had a major concussion or those types of injuries. If you have internal injuries, they can like blow up inside you. And I could have gone home to see Jesus then. But it's all right. Because God has a plan in all these things. He really does. And I'm very thankful for that. Now, a few people have said to me, oh, you're so lucky. And I can tell you that that's the one thing I'm not, for a number of reasons. But luck has nothing to do with it. It really doesn't. And again, you guys have been so awesome with your compassion and cards and food and all kinds of stuff. It's just really been a blessing. I even got a call from my insurance agent. Oh, I can't make this up. The insurance agent called me up and said, hey, you know, you had that accident back in July. I said, yeah, yeah. She says, yeah, that's terrible. And then you had this. And she said, you know, bad things often come in threes. I wasn't going to leave the house, and I had to finally leave to come here this morning. As soon as I go home, I'm going to stay in. I've got this little tinfoil hat that I'm making. Seriously, my brain has been in a fog. It's been in a fog until this past Thursday, and it's almost like somebody took a wet blanket off of my head. So Wednesday, I came here for staff meeting. I have no idea what we talked about. I remember it was Steve Nemeth and Pastor Steve's birthday, and they had a cake. We had a cake, right? And the weirdest thing was, Chris came out with this cake, and we started singing Happy Birthday. And my first clue that I was not right I couldn't match the notes. I couldn't sing it. I was like, hey, hey. And I thought, you just need to shut up. They're going to put you away. And so I knew. And by the time that 5 hours was done, I was all hot and sweaty. I needed to get home. I went home, slept for 3 hours, and it was like, whew, man, finally. It's been weird. It's been really weird. And so they asked me, are you going to speak on Sunday? And I said, oh, yeah, I'll speak. And then somebody wrote me, and they said, so if in the middle of your message you say, look, a squirrel. And I did say that in the first service, but I had total reason to. It was, you had to be there. As you can imagine, my friend Roger has been very distraught over this. We talk every day, and he immediately looked at it and said, what is the Lord trying to teach us? You know, what is God trying to tell us? And me being the deep thinker I was, I would say, well, he's probably telling us we've done stupid things all our life, and finally now it's caught up with us a little bit. I don't know how many times I should have died with Roger. My wife is very reluctant to come along next time we get together. But as my mind is beginning to clear, and I wasn't supposed to read, like I said, or any of those things, so we're not in Joshua today. Are you all right with that? So Lord willing, we'll be in Joshua next week. But I have thought about how amazing it is when you have no time prior to meeting the Lord. There have been several people who have passed away recently, and many of them tell of time leading up to their last breath, where you could go visit them, knew that they were going to pass away, but they had opportunity to stop and think and pray and search their hearts and their souls. And I thought to myself how interesting it is. I was sitting in the back of this boat, and I had no reason to believe anything bad was going to happen that day. We were going back to Pine Island. We were going to go back to Roger's house. It was Karen's birthday, and I was taking everybody out for supper. I was looking forward to that. I sat on the back of this cooler. I remember when I sat down on it, I thought, this is a terrible place to sit. Being in a boat all my life and growing up, you don't like to sit on things that are not anchored down. And we'd taken this cooler out, and we'd placed it in the stern of the boat. And I mean to tell you, when we hit, it was like a missile, and I went forward really fast. And that probably contributed to a lot of the difficulty that we had. Karen's broken her arm, and she's had it repaired this week. Tuesday, she had surgery. They put a plate in and screws, and she's in a like semi-cast type of thing. She'll need months of therapy and so forth to try to bring the mobility back. But what really stands out to me is how quickly I could be in the presence of the Lord. No time to take care of anything. No time to prepare. Now I'm prepared. If it happens today, I know I'm going to meet Jesus, and I know that he'll have me there because of my faith in Jesus Christ and in that alone. I know that eternity in heaven is guaranteed because of the blood of Christ that paid for my sin. I know that. But there is something that just strikes me about the awesomeness of God, and I just want a running start if possible, because I want to spend some time making sure that all my sin is confessed, that I'm close with my Lord, and I'm ready to see him. But there was no time. If indeed that would have happened, that I would be in the presence of the Lord, it would have happened instantly. Again, people say you're lucky, and I wonder sometimes. I'm not lucky. This was all part of God's plan for my life. I want you to take just a second and turn with me here to Philippians, but before I while you're turning there to Philippians, let me just read James chapter 4. James chapter 4 says, you don't know what your life will be like tomorrow, for we're just a vapor that appears for a little while and then it vanishes. Think of boiling some water on the stove and you're done, and the vapor that's been coming off of the boiling water, as soon as you take that off the stove, it usually just goes right away, doesn't it? I know that my life with regard to eternity really is short, and my life is like that vapor that soon passes away. But one thing we should never forget is even though our life may be short, it's not unimportant. It's not insignificant in any way. The Apostle Paul writes in Philippians chapter 1 in verse 21, he says, "For me to live is Christ." And then he says this, he says, "To die is gain. But if I'm to live on in the flesh, this will mean fruitful labor for me, and I do not know which to choose. But I'm hard pressed from both directions, having the desire to depart and be with Christ, for that is very much better. Yet to remain on in the flesh is more necessary for your sake." Paul's determination here is that Christ is everything. In Colossians chapter 3 and verse 4, the Apostle Paul writes, "Christ who is our life." And for the Apostle Paul, what he means by saying that, and what he means by saying here, "For me to live is Christ," is that Christ was the driving force in his life on a daily basis. The other things in life were not that important. What was most significant in Paul's life was his relationship to Jesus Christ and living out a life of productivity for Jesus Christ. This was what was the impetus behind Paul's every step, his every breath, his every movement. And so when Paul looked at life, he would contrast life with simply, it's either life here and living for Jesus here, or it's life there and I'm in the presence of Jesus Christ. One thing that never changes for Paul, and incidentally, it's one thing that should never change for you and me, is the fact that Jesus Christ is everything to me, whether I'm here or whether I'm there. There's no difference. Jesus is everything. So there is Paul, and he describes what's happening in his life when he begins to talk about pressure. He says, "I'm hard pressed," verse 23, "from both directions." There are two things that are pressing upon the Apostle Paul, and these two things are living and dying. Leaving this world, and my Christ is my everything, to being with him in heaven. I think it's the King James that says, "I'm in a strait betwixt two. I'm getting pressure. I'm not sure which direction I need to go." But one thing is clear for the Apostle Paul, he is feeling pressure from both sides. There is equal pressure being placed upon him to leave and go into the presence of the Lord, and there is equal pressure being placed upon him to stay and remain in his fleshly body and do the work of the Lord while God has called him to do that. Paul says that life is short, but it's also purposeful. Notice with me here in this passage, he says, "I have this desire, this passion to depart and be with Christ." But he says in verse 24, "Yet to remain on in the flesh is more necessary for your sake." When he says he is willing to remain on in the flesh, there are two things that stand out to me about the flesh that I deal with every day. One is I have a sin nature that I am loving the idea of getting rid of in the future. Number two, I have a corruptible body, and this body must put up on incorruption. That's what 1 Corinthians 15 is all about. And so those are the two big problems. I have a body that's decaying, and I have a sin nature that's wanting to strive. And so those two aspects are motivation for us as we look towards the future. Because we're in the presence of the Lord, we will have neither one, a corruptible body, one that is decaying, or one that has an influence by a sin nature. Isn't that wonderful? Well, Paul says, I'm willing to tolerate the flesh. That means the sin nature and the decaying body. I'm willing to overcome that and stay ministering to you, because he says here, I'll remain there because it's more necessary for your sake. Paul has come to the realization in his life that there is something more important, get this, than himself. Notice the next word in the next sentence. It says convinced in the New American Standard. Other places, it's I'm confident of this very thing. The idea there in the original language is a thought process that leads you to understand, this is my settled conviction. You have settled convictions on certain things. You do. Without a doubt, you have settled convictions. We all do. And most of the convictions that we have, we've thought out that whole process, and it's led us to the point where we say, this is what I believe on this. I realize that there are times when people haven't thought through a lot of things and they say their convictions. But most of us have done the mental exercise. This is what Paul says. I've done the mental exercise. I've thought it all through. And my conclusion is that it's better if I deal with this flesh issue and continue here to work in your world and minister to you. So he says, I'm convinced and I know that I will remain and continue with you for your progress and the joy of your faith. There was work that needed to be done. On the one hand, Paul says, I have a passion to depart. That means literally weighing the anchor, pulling the anchor up. It's time to get out of this world and get on to the next. That's where I'm going to spend all my eternity. But Paul says, I'm willing to abide in the flesh and deal with all the nastiness of this world so that I can be an encouragement to you, so I can minister to you. I'll do this because I believe that that is what God has for me to do. Paul realized that God could call him home at any time. And the one thing that this accident has taught me is that God can call Kevin home anytime. I could have just as easy opened my eyes and not seen the lady in the ambulance strapping me in, but rather I could have seen the angel of the Lord. Now, I won't digress and go into which I'd rather have seen. But the truth of the matter is, it is God who's in control. Now, the Apostle Paul knows something, and we do well to understand the stuff he knows that we don't know. Because if you say to me, Kevin, you have the option. You can either wake up and be in the presence of the Lord eternity, or you can come back to minister the Word of God. As much as I love teaching the Word of God, being with Jesus Christ is far better than being with you. You say, well, the pastor, I don't. I'm only quoting scripture. Notice what Paul says there in that verse. And I'm going to drag you over to another place here in the New Testament. Paul says, having the desire, the passion to depart and be with Christ, for that is what? Yeah, far better. Far better. So what you've got to do is, as you're thinking through all of Scripture, is you think through, yes, there is motivation to continue to minister and see your progress in the faith. There is ministry opportunities to produce the joy of the Lord and see you as joyous. But understand this, that the Apostle Paul in 2 Corinthians chapter 12 speaks, and last service I was in, we were in 1 Corinthians 12. I was trying to read 1 Corinthians 12 and it wasn't working. And that's when I said, look, a squirrel. but here we are in 2 Corinthians. He says, boasting is necessary, though it's not profitable. But I'll go on to visions and revelations of the Lord. I know a man, that's himself he's speaking of, in Christ, who 14 years ago, whether in the body, I do not know, or out of the body, I do not know, God knows, such a man was caught up to the third heaven. The Apostle Paul had an experience there that is absolutely amazing. And the amazing thing is he writes this and he speaks there in 2 Corinthians of a time that was 14 years prior to him writing 2 Corinthians. This would put that experience somewhere around 43 AD. When you come to Philippians chapter 1 and the Apostle Paul is saying to be with Christ is far better, understand this. He writes that and it's almost 20 years later. And so this has happened prior to Paul saying that being with Christ is far better. In other words, what we're to understand is that Paul had a glimpse that you and I have not had. And even with that glimpse, he recognizes there is a passion to depart this world, but there is a reason to stay and minister. Paul wouldn't be in charge of when he leaves planet Earth. It would be ultimately God. It's true. But understand this. You might not be an apostle, but you are here as a follower of Jesus Christ to influence others for Jesus Christ. There are people that are in your life that God has placed in your life so that you can have a positive impact in their world. Maybe it's sharing Christ. Maybe it's sharing Christ with a grandchild. Maybe it's being able to be an example. I will say this, there are people watching us as Christians, many more than we know, many more than we'll ever understand until we get to heaven. There are people watching how you go through trials of your life and what your outcome is. You are a very important part of what God is doing. Don't ever be discouraged and think that your life is not purposeful. It is purposeful. You don't have to be a Bible teacher. You don't have to be a preacher. You don't have to be, you just be a follower of Jesus. And you let Christ show forth in your life. And you let the fruit of the Spirit of God to be evident to others. It is a wonder what we can accomplish for Jesus Christ. And God, understand this, God has us here to do this ministry and do this work for as long as he thinks it best. In John chapter 17, Jesus said to God the Father, oh, I wish they were all in heaven beholding my glory. Wouldn't it be something that every person who comes to faith in Christ just automatically vaporized and went into the glory of Christ? You say, well, could God do that? Yeah, but he doesn't. He wants us here because he has this treasure in earthen vessels. And so you make a difference and I make a difference. I could be in the presence of God right now if he wanted it to be that way. And I don't want to wig you out, but the truth of the matter is you could be too. You could be too. God has us here for a purpose, doesn't he? I've thought about the purposes of this life. I've thought about how wonderful it is to be able to exclaim the glories of God. And I was drawn to Psalm chapter 71. And Psalm chapter 71, the psalmist writes there about a relationship that he has with God. And he is just filled with some really joyous thoughts here. In Psalm chapter 71, he cries out to the Lord in verse 12, O God, do not be far from me. O my God, hasten to my help. And then in verse 14, he says, but as for me, I will hope continually. That is who my God is, and I am going to hope continually, and I'll praise you yet more and more. My mouth shall tell of your righteousness and of your salvation all the day long, for I do not know the sum of them. And then he goes on and he says, oh God, you have taught me from my youth, verse 17, and I still declare your wondrous deeds. And even when I'm old and gray, oh God, do not forsake me until I declare your strength to this generation, your power to all who are to come. The Apostle Paul was still there ministering because he was called upon to exclaim the righteousness of God, the glory of God, and the power of God. And this is why God wants us to be here. And even though we may get old and gray, he says, listen, keep on exclaiming the glories of God, the righteousness of God. This next generation needs to hear how great God truly is. And who better to hear it from than people who love him and follow him and are trusted by those in your family and in your circle of friends. You see, you're here for a reason, and I'm here for a reason. And it has nothing to do with this world and this world's stuff. Because frankly, you can have it all. You want to give me a choice as to whether or not I want to be in heaven enjoying Christ, which is far better? Or here on earth ministering the word of God? You see, God says, I've made my mind. I want you here. I want you doing this. And I love the word of God. God has called us all to be influencers to those around us. I'm not sure I'm looking forward to this coming year. I have the opportunity to teach for 10 days, 6 hours a day in China. Isn't that great? I'm looking forward to that. I'll be teaching men who are pastors. They know God's word better than I do, but they don't know how to interpret certain passages. They don't understand the systematic theologies and certain other things. And so there's a group that goes over and teaches them. I'm excited about that. I guess God didn't want to fill in with another pastor that course. It's all about people, isn't it? It's all about ministering to one another. This is why we're here. You can pray for us this week. My wife's not here today. She was here last week. She had, as I mentioned, surgery on Tuesday, and she's doing really well. She really is. The pain has not been horrible, and she's just flourishing. On Thursday, we had our son and grandkids and son and daughter-in-law come and visit us on Thursday. This was a trip that was planned for the last 6 months. They were going to Dubai, and we're to watch the grandkids. And they came up and they said, we're not sure we're going to leave. But they left. And even though it's challenging, not too long ago, 2 weeks ago, our daughter-in-law lost her mom, passed away, 63 years old. And she's been by her mother's bedside for a month. And Dave's been taking care of the boys for a month. And this is an opportunity for them to get back together, get relaxation, and spend some meaningful time together. And regardless of how I feel, how Karen feels, we felt like it was important for them to go. And you can pray for us. We need strength. More than you know. 9 months old, 2 years. But you know what's important? What's important is people are important. And putting other people first. That's exactly what Paul's talking about there in Philippians 1. I want you to see that. He says, you know, it'd be far better for me to be with Jesus, but I'm here with you guys. I'm in this stinking flesh. I'm dealing with sin nature. I'm dealing with a decaying body. Eventually, he's going to be put to death for his faith in Christ. But he says, I'm going to do it because I love you and I love the Lord. This is what God wants me to do. Using your life for Christ is why we're still here. And sometimes he calls his saints home because there needs to be celebrations in heaven on a regular basis. Amen. There it does. I look forward to that day. But until that day comes, I want to be useful for the Lord Jesus Christ. And again, it's not about this world's stuff because there's not enough reason to be here for this world's stuff. It's about people. It's about sharing the good news of Jesus Christ with people and encouraging brothers and sisters in the Lord to see how wonderful our God is. Can you do that? That's what God's wanting us to do. Let's pray. This morning, we're blessed to be able to stop and consider the words of the apostle. We rejoice at his relationship with Christ and the fact that Christ is everything to him. Maybe you're here this morning and God's been really stoking the fire in your heart. And God, you know, wants you to have a similar attitude in your heart and mind, to understand that you're not here for yourself. You're not here to enjoy what this world has. You're here because you're on a mission for Christ. Maybe you're here and you'd say, Pastor Kevin, God's been speaking to my heart today. I talked to one gentleman after the service, the early service. He said, man, he said, you didn't know, but I've been praying this prayer for 4 weeks. God's been at work in my heart. Maybe you're here today and you say, Pastor, pray for me. God's truly at work in my heart. Just slip up your hand and I can pray for you. I'd love to do it today. This is where I'm at too, guys. It really is. Amen. Amen. Yeah, praise the Lord. May God be at work in all of our hearts. I encourage you this morning, if you're unsure of your relationship to Jesus Christ, whether or not he is your Savior, that you would understand that the Scripture tells us clearly that we can have eternal life through Jesus Christ and him alone. If you've never put your faith in Jesus Christ, I urge you today to call upon his name. For the Bible says you will be saved. Saved from the consequences of your sin. Given eternal life. All because Jesus Christ has paid for your sin on the cross. If you want more information about that, there are folks here at the front of the service afterwards that would love to talk to you more in depth about how you can have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Let's stand. We'll have a word of prayer here this morning. Our Father in heaven, we thank you, Lord, for the work that you do in all of our hearts and minds. And Lord, today I lift up my brothers and sisters in Christ. Father, there were some here this morning, many actually, that would say, Lord, do a work in my heart. Help me to have that same spirit that we see in the Apostle Paul. A willingness to lay self aside and be everything that you want us to be as individuals. Father, I just thank you for the lessons of life that you teach us. The Holy Spirit being so active in our lives, Lord, we just rejoice in that. Continue to move and work, I pray, in hearts today. Father, too, I lift up anyone here today who's not certain of their eternal destination, not sure what kind of relationship they have with Christ. May they not leave here today until they make certain that Jesus is their Savior. Father, thank you for giving to us everything we need to live a joyous life, a blessed life. We thank you for all of it. Give us a great week, Lord, ahead, I pray, in Christ's name. Amen.